Hello and welcome to our online service for the churches of St Andrews in Bucknell-on-a-Corum and the Church of the Holy Spirit, Milton Coombe. In the words of morning prayer from Common Worship, grace, mercy and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you. Well, friends, we're delighted that you are with us today. As we begin, let's do so by joining in a prayer together. Let's pray. Almighty and everlasting God, we thank you that you have brought us safely to the beginning of this day. Keep us from falling into sin or running into danger. Order us in all our doings, and guide us to do always what is right in your eyes. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Well, it's clear from a number of conversations I've had this week with people over the phone, contact that's been made via Zoom or email, that there are many of us who are just feeling flat, a little bit fed up with things as they are at the moment. And many have articulated that their feelings are very different in this latest lockdown than those that have gone before. Perhaps we are all feeling rather exhausted. We are all looking forward with anticipation to things returning to some sort of normality. I think the Psalms are often a really helpful place to go when we are struggling with our feelings, when we're trying to make sense of life and the things that are going on day by day. I'd like to just read one verse from Psalm 68. It's Psalm 68 and verse 19. Praise be to the Lord, to God our Saviour, who daily bears our burdens. It's a wonderful verse that reminds us that God draws near to all who love him. He comes alongside, he bears our burdens daily, and therefore he is worthy of our praise. Our first song this morning picks up on that theme. It is a call for all of us to come together to sing our praises to God, to those whose joy is morning sun, to those who are weeping in the night, to those who tell of battles won, to those who are struggling in the fight. We know, don't we, that our emotions ebb and flow. We know that sometimes our feelings can be fickle. But God's perfect love never changes, and his mercies never cease. And therefore God is worthy to be praised. Let's sing this great song together. Come, people of the risen King.
Follow
Today we continue to explore the book of Hebrews. A little bit later, Peter Harlow, one of our readers, will be speaking to us from the next section of this great book. But already, if you've been with us over the last few weeks, you will have seen how the writer points us first and foremost to the person of Jesus. We've seen how Jesus is the final word from God, how he is superior to the angels and to Moses. We've been warned of the danger of drifting away from the truths of the gospel. And we've been reminded, haven't we, to fix our thoughts on Jesus. Well, in just a moment, we're going to have our Bible reading. But before that, we're going to rehearse the tenets of our faith by saying together the creed. So if you'd like to, please join me in saying these words together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Well, as I mentioned, we're now going to have our Bible reading. I hope you have a Bible to hand at home. And I'm going to hand over to Callie. So thank you, Callie, for this morning's reading.
Today's reading is taken from Hebrews chapter 4, beginning at the first verse. A Sabbath rest for the people of God. Therefore, since the promise of entering his rest still stands, let us be careful that none of you be found to have fallen short of it. For we also have had the good news proclaimed to us, just as they did, but the message they heard was of no value to them because they did not share the faith of those who obeyed. Now we who have believed enter that rest just as God has said. So I declared an oath in my anger, they shall never enter my rest. And yet his works have been finished since the creation of the world. For somewhere he has spoken about the seventh day in these words. On the seventh day God rested from all of his works. And again in the passage above he says, they shall never enter my rest. Therefore, since it still remains for some to enter that rest, and since those who formerly had the good news proclaimed to them did not go in because of their disobedience, God again set a certain day, calling it today. This he did when a long time later he spoke through David, as in the passage already quoted. Today, if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts. For if Joshua had given them rest, God would not have spoken later about another day. There remains then a Sabbath rest for the people of God. For anyone who enters God's rest also rests from their works, just as God did from his. Let us therefore make every effort to enter that rest, so that no one will perish by following their example of disobedience. For the Lord of God, the word of God is alive and active, sharper than any double-edged sword. It penetrates even to dividing soul and spirit, joints and marrow. It judges the thoughts and attitudes of the heart. Nothing in all creation is hidden from God's sight. Everything is uncovered and laid bare before the eyes of him to whom we must give account. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Hello there. My name is Peter Harlow. I'm one of the lay readers serving the Church of the Holy Spirit and St Andrew's. Some very long-standing friends call me the big silent one. Generally, I don't speak a great deal, but from a young age, I felt compelled to speak of my faith in Jesus, my Lord, Saviour and friend. It's my prayer that the Holy Spirit will speak to you today via my words and the pictures on the screen as well. Today we're going to take a look at belief and the dangers of Christians giving up and quitting because they doubt God and his promises. Hebrews was written about 40 years after Jesus died and then rose to life. The same time span between Moses leaving Egypt and Joshua entering the promised land. Jesus was expected to return to claim his kingdom. Doubt was setting in, particularly because the Christians were being persecuted by their Jewish community. It would be easy for them to drift back to their Jewish roots. Today, we are told that we live in a post-truth age, so deciding what to believe is difficult. Few of us are experts or have undertaken fundamental research. While we have been educated, much of we know is now Googled from Google. As an engineer, I believe in the truth of many physical laws about gravity and motion, material properties and thermodynamics. These start as hypotheses, a proposal, and then experiments provide evidence to support them or modify them. My belief is proven as I use these laws to design objects. Machines, aircraft, ships, and the like. As a Christian, I can't prove that God exists, and so my belief is based on experience. Experience is people who have demonstrated Christ-like behaviour and their lifestyle in the here and now, but also the stories of God's relationship with people in the past. The other indicator I have is that when I get to read the Bible, that it speaks directly to me. God knows my thoughts and my heart. We'll come back to this later. But my belief in God is only demonstrated as I act on what I've learnt and experienced. If I trust Jesus and my life reflects his priorities, that's fine. Otherwise, I'm being rebellious and unbelieving, possibly a hypocrite. The unbelief we are talking about today in Hebrews is in our relationship to our trust and obedience to God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, not about knowledge and science concerning the world. We live in disturbing times where people crave certainty. This can lead to extremism or to bigoted intolerance, as we have seen in the American politics and religion. These times can paralyse us and lead us to inaction. But equally, some Christians are overreacting and flouting social distancing and mask wearing, as if it's contrary to the freedoms God has given us. We are called by the living God to trust and obey him, and to work out our salvation day by day. Let's turn to God's word in Hebrews to see what he has in mind for us today. Hebrews is primarily an exhortation for Christian believers to keep moving on with God, not to quit, as Thomas indicated in his family focus. Hebrews identifies various routes to failure. Hebrews keeps pointing us to Jesus and all that he has done for us. Last week, Andy alluded to the risk of drift, being carried out by the tide, almost unawares. Today we're going to take at something far more serious, rebellion and unbelief. While we look at these dangers individually, they inevitably interlink. Before we go on, I'd like to pose a question here. If you were writing Hebrews, what order would you place these dangers in? The danger of unbelief is the longest warning, and the consequence of unbelief is that the Christians do not entertain the promised rest, and the Israelites did not enter the promised land. This is a long passage with a complex argument, so if you've got time, I'd like you to pause the video and read Hebrews chapter 3 verse 7 to chapter 4 verse 13. To understand the warning, we have to grasp the example of unbelief that is cited in Hebrews 3, that of the refusal of the Israelites to enter the promised land. This takes us back to our previous series on Exodus, the God who saves, and particularly what God said to Moses at the burning bush, and what Moses was instructed to say to the elders. This is what he was told to say. Go, assemble the elders of Israel and say to them, the Lord, the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, Isaac and Jacob, appeared to me and said, I have watched over you and have seen what has been done to you in Egypt. And I have promised to bring you out of your misery in Egypt into the land of the Canaanites, Hittites, Amorites, Perizzites, Hivites and Jebusites, a land flowing in milk and honey. From that reading, we can see God's express purpose was to bring the Israelites to a destination, the Promised Land, a named location. The Israelites had experienced God in many tangible ways in their journey. They'd heard Moses speaking of this plan. They'd seen the plagues that disrupted Egyptian life. They were saved by the paschal lamb's blood on the doorposts, and their firstborn lived. They took the riches of Egypt, and then they followed a column of cloud and fire into the desert. That cloud protected them from the Egyptians. Moses raised his arm and they went through the Red Sea, but the army of Egypt was destroyed. The Israelites were provided with meat, bread and water, despite grumbling. They received the Ten Commandments and a covenant, despite idolatry. Armies had been defeated by their action and by the prayers of Moses. They built a tabernacle that experienced God's presence. They built furnishings to aid worship. They had a priesthood with regalia, sacrifices and festivals. And finally, they reached the Promised Land's border after 2 years in the desert. They sent in 12 spies, one for each tribe. 10 of those spies sowed fear, talking of giants in the land, but two confirm the bounty of the land. The elders of the people refused to believe in God and trust in his promise, so they turned aside. The punishment of disobedience and unbelief that God would keep his promise meant that only two of the 600,000 men leaving Egypt would enter the promised land, Caleb and Joshua, the spies who had said, "Let's go in and claim the land." So how does this apply to the Christians in the Hebrews passage? They had inherited many promises. We've already heard in chapters 1 and 2 that Jesus was fully God and fully man, able to understand and help us. Jesus is the Saviour of the world. He redeems us as individuals as we turn to him. He brings us into the body of the church and gives us a new responsive heart to hear him. Jesus sends the Holy Spirit to live in us, to give us the fruit of the Spirit and gifts for service. We are offered eternal rest and an eternal inheritance as sons and daughters of God. The implication of Hebrews 3 and 4 is they may not attain that rest. Certainly not those with sinful, unbelieving hearts, those who are disobedient to God's voice via the Holy Spirit, those who do not persevere to the end. We're familiar with other expressions of this from the New Testament, implying the same. Are we sheep or goats? Wheat or weeds? Saved or condemned? Have we gone in through the narrow gate, or are we on the broad road? Do we see and ignore Jesus in those around us? It's time now to see how we can apply this warning to ourselves and focus on the four bits of guidance embedded in these verses from Hebrews. Today, don't harden your hearts. Unbelief and resulting disobedience begin when we fail to hear what God is telling us via the Holy Spirit. And if we do know the truth and don't act on it, we are rebelling. Hebrews calls this sinful and unbelieving. The importance of today. C.S. Lewis is a favourite of many people my age, and here is a quote that sums up the consequences of our actions and choices each day. Good and evil both increase at compound interest. That is why the little decisions you and I make every day are of such infinite importance. The smallest good act today is the capture of a strategic point from which, a few months later, you may be able to go on to victories you never dreamt of. An apparent trivial indulgence in lust or anger today is the loss of a ridge or railway line or bridgehead from which the enemy may launch an attack otherwise impossible. Each day, you and I make choices for good or evil. Every time we ignore our conscience, we are in fact hardening our hearts. Take, for example, internet pornography. It's a major problem for society, including Christian men and women. Many young people get their sex education from it, and violence and abuse of women continues to grow as a result. My guess is that lockdown has caused this to escalate. Do we trust God for right intimacy, or do we fabricate it in our minds? Drink and gambling are other addictive behaviours that can cripple our witness and lead to guilt and a reticence in standing up for Jesus. Just one more, we say. It won't matter.
But of course it does.
Encouraging one another daily. Hebrews gives us the antidote for this behaviour. Daily encouragement from brothers and sisters. Holding ourselves accountable to one another. Hebrews 3 tells us, "See to it, brothers and sisters, that none of you have a sinful, unbelieving heart that turns away from the living God. But encourage one another daily, as long as it is called today, so that none of you may be hardened by sinful deceitfulness. We have come to share in Christ, if indeed we hold on to our original conviction, firmly to the very end." To encourage one another means for us to give courage, to share courage with one another, to keep on going and not to quit, despite the circumstances that surround us. Sometimes God may seem completely absent or deaf, but we are to keep on trusting and obeying him, based on his promises and his word. The final piece of advice is to allow the word of God to do its work in us. Our reading today ends with a very famous passage. "For the word of God is alive and active, sharper than any double-edged sword. It penetrates even to divide the soul and spirit, joints and marrow. It judges the thoughts and attitudes of the heart. Nothing in all creation is hidden from God's sight. Everything is uncovered and laid bare before the eyes of him to whom we must give account." We can see this passage from two perspectives, God and ours. God sees us for who we are. He knows the state of our hearts, whether we are hard or soft, rebellious or obedient, doubting or inquisitive. For ourselves, the Bible can enlighten us, expose to us our underlying motives, give us the chance to be changed by the Holy Spirit. I spoke of this earlier. As we read the Bible, it speaks to us, and our relationship with Jesus comes alive. As we now start to draw to a close, let's leave the final word to Jesus. Matthew's Gospel was probably written after Hebrews. The writer of Hebrews may have had an oral version of Jesus' life and teaching, but it's encouraging to hear Jesus' promise of rest alongside that of the rest described in Hebrews. In this passage, Jesus is not offering a final rest as seen in Hebrews, but a rest in the present, when we are weary and burdened by life circumstances. The rest he offers is to share the load with us, being alongside us. Rest is spoken about in the context of taking on a yoke. So rest here is not the absence of work or labour, but the knowledge that we share that burden, that we are yoked to Jesus, our Saviour and friend. This is Matthew chapter 11. "Come to me, all of you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light." As Christian brothers and sisters, we are to share one another's burdens, encourage one another to keep on going in our Christian faith and not quit.
Let us pray. Today, Heavenly Father, please soften any hardness of heart that we may have. Incline us to listen and happily obey your voice as we hear it in Scripture and from your Holy Spirit. We pray for one another, particularly the weary and burdened, that they would find you beside them, sharing or carrying their loads. providing rest. Please help us to walk with our brothers and sisters and offer encouragement so that they don't quit. We ask it for Jesus' sake, that his name may be glorified, now and forever. Amen.
I'm running into your arms of grace. Let us pray. In response to reaching the terrible milestone of 100,000 deaths from COVID-19, the Archbishops are inviting our nation to call on God in prayer. Starting tomorrow, we're encouraged to set aside time every evening to pray, particularly at 6 p.m. More than ever, this is a time when we need to love each other. Prayer is an expression of love. We pray that with cathedrals and churches across the country, we may be joined together laying a foundation for a spirit-led refreshing of our church at this difficult time. Father God, you know how the coronavirus pandemic continues to cast a long shadow over the nations and that we see no end in sight. Lockdown feels heavy, but we pray that it will arrest the spread of the virus and that the reversal in the rate of infections and hospital admissions will continue. We pray that all those who work in the NHS in our area and all those who are working to provide vaccinations will feel protected and supported. In the delivery of vaccine, we pray that countries would work together and set aside their differences in making the best use of scarce resources. We pray that poor countries would be able to share in the benefits of vaccination and that those allocating supplies would not forget their needs. Loving God, at this time of crisis when so many are suffering, we pray for our nation and our world. Give our leaders wisdom, our health service strength, our people hope. Lead us through these parched and difficult days to the fresh springs of joy and comfort that we find in Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We pray for young people and their teachers and parents as they work to keep the learning process going against other distractions and diminishing attention spans. We particularly pray for Sarah Lakey and all of the teachers and staff at St Andrew's School as the team develops under her leadership. So many in our community feel understandably anxious, and it is vital that we look after ourselves as well as take care of others. We pray that as well as attending to our own spiritual life, we can make opportunities to talk with neighbours, friends and colleagues to mitigate any sense of isolation. We pray that we may draw on the wellsprings of our faith and reach out to those in need to reduce that isolation and smooth the harsh effects of lockdown. In the face of uncertainty and anxiety, help us to bring encouragement. Lord, we thank you that we are able to join with your people across the world, bringing the good news of Jesus to so many lives. We thank you that we can directly support workers in the field and pray for Matt and Becky with Missionary Aviation Fellowship in Chad, particularly for flight safety and opportunities to reach out to remote communities. We also thank you for the safe return of Tristan and Sarah from their work with refugees in Lesbos. We pray for them as they await the birth of their second child and for guidance as they plan the next stage of their mission. As we heard in our passage today from Hebrews, for the word of God is alive and active, sharper than any double-edged sword. It brings even to dividing soul and spirit, joints and marrow. It judges the thoughts and attitudes of the heart. This Tuesday, the church celebrates the presentation of Jesus in the temple, known as Candlemas, and we pray in the words of the Collect for Candlemas. Almighty and ever-living God, clothed in majesty, whose beloved Son was presented in the temple in substance of our flesh, grant that we may be presented to you with pure and clean hearts, by your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Our final prayer this Sunday is for our family, friends and loved ones. We lift to you, God, those who we hold in our hearts, praying for their health, their well-being and their sense of hope. We pray that even when loved ones cannot physically be together, they would not feel apart. We ask for your help, Lord, in our communicating, our connecting, and our caring. And in a moment's silence, we pray for those known to us. Gracious God, as we remember before you the thousands who have died, surround us and all who mourn with your strong compassion. Be gentle with us in our grief. Protect us from despair and give us grace to persevere and face the future with hope. In Jesus Christ, our risen Lord. Amen.
Paul, thank you so much for your prayers. We come now to our closing hymn today. It's a wonderful hymn that describes for us the journey of God's ancient people through that time of the Exodus, their journey through the Red Sea on their way towards the Promised Land, pictures which Peter alluded to in his sermon. And of course, this description is a picture for us, a picture of the New Testament believer's journey towards that great new creation, that eternal rest that God promises to all who believe and trust in Jesus. Our wonderful final hymn is a hymn I think we need to all stand for, to fill our lungs with and sing along together. So let's do that now as we sing, Guide Me, O Thou Great Redeemer. As our service draws to a close, may I just remind you that we have our Zoom cafe at 11 o'clock this morning. It'd be great to see lots of you there to catch up and chat over tea and coffee. And then on Wednesday of this week at 8 o'clock in the evening, we have our central prayer meeting. So please do mark that in your diary. Come along ready to pray for all sorts of different things as we lift our needs, the needs of our community, our country, and indeed our world, before our great and good God. As we close, a prayer. May the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep our hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, remain with us and with those we love, now and for evermore. Amen. Friends, let us go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen.